एज पार्ट ऑफ द फ्लूड मैकेनिक्स एंड हाइड्रोलिक इंजीनियरिंग. विल सी दैट एंड विल गो फर्दर. Firstly, we'll discuss the syllabus, that is the content which is therein for the GATE examination. The first part is about the fluid mechanics, that is which you have studied in this first semester, that is the introduction to fluid mechanics, that is the fluid mechanics one, we can say. In that, the first part is about the properties of the fluids, then fluid statics, continuity and momentum equation, along with the energy equation and related equations to that, then potential flows, applications of momentum and energy equations, laminar and turbulent flow, that is the different types of the flows are there, then flow through the pipes, then pipe networks, concept of boundary layer and its growth, that is from the first part, that is fluid mechanics, we can say. The next part is about the hydraulics. In that, it includes the forces on immersed bodies, that when the bodies will be immersed in the liquid, then how much amount of the force will be exerted on it. Then flow measurement in the channels and the pipes. It is a different instrument, those are used for the measurement of the flow. That may be the pitot tube, that may be the anemometer, etc., etc. Along with that, we have to go for the measurement of the pressure also by using the different manometers, Bourdon's tube, and allied instruments. After that, dimensional analysis. The dimensional analysis is the part included in the hydraulic engineering, that is a fluid mechanics part two. That also we are going to deal in details. Then hydraulic similitude, that is the hydraulic similitude is the part of the dimensional analysis itself. Then kinematics of the flow. Then the velocity triangles. The velocity triangles are related to the impact of the jets, turbines, and the centrifugal pumps. That is inlet velocity triangle and outlet velocity triangles. Then the basic of hydraulic machines. That is the turbines and the pumps that in detail I worked on efficiencies, etc. Then specific speed of the pumps and the turbines. That is for the part of the hydraulics, we can say. Then the channel hydraulics, that is the next part from the fluid mechanics. So channel hydraulics includes the energy depth relationships, specific energy, critical flow, slope profiles, hydraulic jump, uniform flow, and gradually varied flow. So energy depth relationship is the regarding the depth of the flow, then critical depth of the flow, normal depth of the flow, and as per that, the different types. Of the channel slopes, that is mild, steep, adverse, etc., etc. Okay, after that, we have to study about the uniform flow computations, gradually and rapidly varied flow conditions. So this is all about the syllabus which we have to cover. Now near about 53 participants are there, so I would like to go for the next one, that is the actual syllabus we will go for. So the today we are going to cover about the properties of the fluids. So fluids and the fluid mechanics we will go for. From the basics we will start. So what is meant by a fluid firstly? So all of you are knowing the fluid. We are using the fluid in a day-to-day life. So what does it mean about? The fluid is nothing but the any substance which is capable to flow. When the fluid used to flow, so whenever there is a deformation of the layers or the deformation of the particles, then the substance used to flow. And that deformation is nothing but the shear deformation. So whenever the shear deformation occurs, the substance starts flowing. For example, whenever we used to exert a pressure on the air or on a water, in that case, it spreads. That spreading is nothing but the flowing, we can consider. So the any substance which is capable of flow or which deforms continuously under the action of the shear force, that is considered as in a fluid. If you consider the fluid, then it has some characteristics. Those characteristics are nothing but it has no definite shape. But whenever it will be contained in any container, it used to acquire or it used to possess the shape of that particular container or the vessel. For example, if you pour the water in a jar, it takes the shape of the jar. If you pour the water in the glass, it takes the shape of the glass. It pour the water in the cup, it takes the shape of the cup. So here we can say that the fluids don't have their own shape, but whenever we used to pour them inside any vessel, they used to confirm the shape of that vessel. This is the unique characteristic we can consider here. Then the next characteristics is about all the liquids and the gases are the fluids. So if you consider the liquids and the gases, all they fall under the category of the fluids. But there is a difference between the liquid and gases. When to say the fluid as a liquid and when to say the fluid as a gas. If you consider the liquid is having a definite volume, but it is non-compressible in nature. If you consider once again an example of water, then it is not having its own shape. That is, it is not having its definite volume. Again, so liquids are having the definite volume, but they are non-compressible in a nature. Means if you compress the water, it will not get easily. But the compression rate or the reduction in the volume will be so less. It means that they are having a definite volume that doesn't change under the action of the pressure. An example is a water. Again, another characteristic of the liquid is that whatever the molecules of the liquid are there or the water are there, those molecules are having the molecular attraction more than that of the gas. That is, the cohesive force of the liquids is more as compared to the cohesive force of the gas. This is another unique characteristic of a liquid. Then for the gas is a fluid, but which is not having the definite volume. Why they are not having definite volume? Because they are getting compressed. As they are getting compressed, means their volume is getting changed under the application of the pressure or the force. That's why they are considered as a compressible fluids with a non-definite volume. An example, standard example is air. The next part we'll discuss about what is mean by a fluid mechanics. So fluid mechanics is nothing but the study of the fluids or the study of the forces acting on the fluid when the fluids are at rest or they are in a motion. So here we can say that the study of the behavior of the fluids. So study of the behavior of the fluids under the application of the forces is nothing but the fluid mechanics. Then if you consider the tree diagram, then we will find that the fluid mechanics is divided into the two parts. There is statics and dynamics. Whenever you used to consider the statics part talks about the behavior of the fluids under the application of the forces when they are at a rest. So whenever we are applying the forces on a fluid which is contained in a jar or in a vessel, which is not moving at all, or which is not allowed to move, then in that case, that study is considered as an statics or fluid statics. Whereas, whenever the forces acting on the fluid are studied, when the fluid is in motion, in that case, that fluid mechanics is considered as a dynamics. Means the behavior of the fluids under the application of the forces, when the fluid is in motion, is considered as a dynamics. Whereas the study of the behavior of the fluids under the application of the forces, when the fluid is at a rest, that is under the fluid statics. So under the dynamics, there are two parts. There is a kinetics and kinematics. So what does it they mean? So kinetics is nothing but the, again, the part of the dynamics, that is a fluid dynamics, means fluid will be in a motion. Forces are acting on that. We have to study the behavior of the fluid, but here we have to consider the forces, those are causing motion to the fluid. Means here we have to consider the mass of the fluid. If you consider the forces causing the motion, means generally we will consider the motion of the motion, means generally we will consider. Please stop the audios. All the participants are requested to stop their audios. We're discussing about the kinetics. So kinetics is nothing but the fluid dynamics once again. Here we're studying about the behavior of the fluid in the motion under the application of the forces by considering the mass. That is by considering the forces causing the motion. Means by considering the gravity we can say. So whenever we are considering about the open channel flows, in that case the forces causing the motion will be the gravity, and in the pipe flow there will be the pressure. So if those forces are considered, those are responsible to have the motion to the fluid, in that case that study comes under the kinetics. Whereas under the kinematics, we doesn't consider the mass of the fluid or the forces causing the motion to the fluid. Means the kinematics is the sub branch of the dynamics under which we are studying the behavior of the fluids under the application of the forces without considering the forces those are causing the motion. That is mass and gravity, we can say in simple way. So this is about the fluid mechanics. So the thing comes in the mind that, so what does it mean about the hydraulics then? So hydraulics is nothing but that. Whenever in the fluid mechanics we used to consider or we used to treat the fluid as a water, in that case that branch is considered as a hydraulics or hydraulic engineering. So whenever we used to consider the fluid as a water, then it will be the hydraulic engineering. And whenever we used to consider any liquid or a gas, in that case it is simply treated as a fluid mechanics. This is about the definition of the fluid and the fluid mechanics. Now we will proceed for the further part, that is the different properties of the fluids. Or first we will go for the, what does it mean about the real fluid or ideal fluid and the imaginary fluid. Whenever we used to talk about ideal fluid, so ideal fluids are imaginary fluids. Why is it so? We'll see them in detail. So ideal fluids are imaginary fluids because they doesn't deforms under the application of the shear forces. That means they doesn't have any viscosity and they doesn't have a surface tension, and they are incompressible in nature. So whenever the any fluid we used to consider that doesn't undergo the compression or doesn't undergoes the change in volume, in that case we used to treat that fluid as a imaginary fluid. Along with that incompressibility, the fluid is having no viscosity or so less viscosity and so less surface tension, those fluids are considered as ideal fluids or imaginary fluids. But most of the times in the study purpose, under ideal conditions, the standard liquid as water and standard gas as air are considered as an ideal fluids. But that to be under the specific conditions. Then the next one is the practical fluids, that is the real fluids, we can say. So the real fluids or the practical fluids are the fluids, they used to possess some viscosity. They undergoes the compression. They undergoes change in pressure. They used to possess the surface tension. And they offers some amount of resistance when they are set in motion. Means they used to possess the viscosity. The viscosity we are going to study in detail in the further part. Time being, the viscosity is nothing but the amount of resistance offered by one layer of a fluid to have the motion of another layer of a fluid over it. And practical fluids used to offer the same. So means they offers a certain amount of resistance when they set in a motion. Those are considered as practical fluids. Okay, so this is about the ideal fluids and the practical fluids. So the next part, we'll go for quiz. Please go through that. Real practical fluid possesses which of the following things? Please read the statement once again. A real practical fluid possesses which of the following? The options are viscosity, then second option is surface tension, next one is compressibility, and last option is all of this. So read the statement carefully and please have answer over it. The statement is, the real practical fluids possesses which of the following? Someone has a D. Okay, again, two answers I got. Number of options I got, someone saying two options are viscosity, one is surface tension. Please don't scratch, just mark a point over there so that I will be able to get the idea how many have the answer there. Just a dot, I got the dot here. So likewise, just mark a dot. Don't scratch over the screen. Anybody else? Go through the statement clearly. A real practical fluids possesses which of the following? Viscosity, surface tension, compressibility, all of the above. Can we go for the answer? Can we go for the answer? The answer is D. That is all of the above. Statement is a jumbling here. A real practical fluid. Some of the participants may got the idea that the real fluid, but real practical fluid means the fluids which were using in a practice. So those fluids consist of viscosity, surface tension, compressibility. Means answer will be all of this. So this is the one of the question which I have taken from the examination which was asked in the IES. So next part we'll go for fluid properties. Please don't scratch over the screen. Okay, so now next property we'll go for is the mass density. Mass density is also considered as a specific mass. So a specific mass, and it is denoted by a density rho. So density rho is nothing but the mass per unit volume. Mass density is defined as mass per unit volume, and its unit is a kg per meter cube. What does it mean about the mass per unit volume? I have used the word per unit volume. It makes the sense that if I would have, or we would have, a volume of 1 unit, then how much amount of the mass will be occupied by that. So in that case, we can say that the amount of the mass possessed by one unit volume, and that ratio is nothing but the density. So the density is nothing but now the mass per unit volume, and is proportional to the number of molecules in a unit volume of the liquid. So now what does it means? Number of the molecules means the how much amount of the particles of the substance those are accommodated in that unit volume. So if the number of molecules or number of atoms, we can say those are admitted in the unit volume are more, in that case obviously density will be more, as mass will be more in that case. So if you consider the all the mass, all the particles are having a some mass, and if such number of particles are united together, they are going to increase into the mass. So density is proportional to the number of molecules in a unit volume of a fluid. Then the for the gases, if you consider the effect of the pressure and temperature, the effect of pressure and temperature over the mass density. For the gases, whenever there is an increase in a temperature, the mass density used to go on decreasing. How it happens? So because for the gases, when the temperature increases, they goes on expanding. There distance between the molecules goes on increasing and increasing. As the distance between the molecules goes on increasing and increasing, for the same number of the molecules those are occupied, in that case definitely the volume goes on increasing and increasing. As mass doesn't changes, it means that as mass doesn't changes means mass will be the constant one, but with increase in the temperature, due to the increase in the distance between the molecules, the volume goes on increasing and increasing. And as the density is inversely proportional to the volume, so as volume increases with the temperature, the density decreases with the temperature. This is the relation for the gases. But in case of the liquids, the change in molecular distance is so less. So whenever the change in molecular distance is so less, in that case there will be a change in the density with the temperature, but that amount will be less. So for liquids, again the density decreases with increase in temperature, but that rate of decrease of the density with increase in temperature is so less as compared to the gases. This is effect of a temperature. The next is the effect of a pressure. So now if you consider the effect of a pressure, in that case we'll observe that with increasing in a pressure, the density also increases. Now how it happens? So as pressure increases, it means that we are trying to have the molecules so close to each other. And whenever the molecules of a unit volume or unit mass comes close to each other, in that case definitely volume is going on decrease and decrease. As the volume decreases, so the density goes on increasing, as there is an inverse proportion between the density and the volume. So with increase in a pressure, volume decreases, and as volume decreases, density increases. This is about the effect of pressure on the density. We'll consider for the some of the standard fluids the what is the density. For the water, if you consider for the water, the unit volume of the water, that is a one unit volume of the water, contains about, or the one unit stands for, if you consider unit as a meter cube, then 1 meter cube of water has the 100 kg of a mass. That is the meaning. It means that for the water, density is 100 kg per meter cube. If we will have the 2 meter cubes, then in that case the mass will be 2000 kg. Likewise, then for the mercury and for air, those are given herein. Here we are finding that for air, the amount of the density is so less. Why is it so? Because the air is to have the particles in it, those are not having the cohesive force as much as compared to the water or as much as compared to the mercury. It means that for a unit volume, the mass of the air is so less as compared to the water and mercury. For the mercury, as we are knowing that the molecules of the mercury are united to each other so tightly, or they are so close to each other, the cohesive force between them is so high. So in that case, they possesses a maximum mass per unit volume. That is the meaning of that. The next one is, as the density changes, as density doesn't changes with the position. Position means a space, we can say. It means that if you have a measure a density of a particular substance at Earth, and density of the same substance has been measured on the moon, in that case, we will find the density as a same one. As the density doesn't changes with the position or the space, we can say. That's why it's considered as an absolute quantity. Density is the absolute quantity. Okay, so then we'll go for the next point. Next property we'll go for is a weight density. Mass density we have considered in the previous slide. That is, we have considered as a specific mass. Now we are going to consider about a specific weight. Specific weight or the weight density is denoted by a gamma, sorry, a mu or a small w. So whenever we used to consider a small gamma or a w, in that case we used to consider it as,
sir,
hello. Is I'm audible?
Sir, आवाज येत नाही.
हा सर्वांनी आपापले व्हिडिओज आणि ऑडिओ बंद करा, जेणेकरून बँडविड्थ तर कमी लागेल, जेणेकरून सर्वांना ऐकता येईल. सो व्हेनेव्हर यू टू स्टार्ट युअर ऑडिओज अँड व्हिडिओज, इन दॅट केस इट बिकम्स सो मच ट्रबल मस. ओके, सो ट्राय टू अवॉइड युअर ऑडिओज अँड व्हिडिओज. So now the next property or the characteristic of the fluid which we are going to consider, we are going to study, is about the weight density, that is a specific weight, which is denoted by the mu or a small w. So this is nothing but the weight per unit volume. In the previous one we had seen that mass per unit volume, that is a mass density, and the weight density is nothing but the weight per unit volume. So we'll simplify it. So mu is equals to weight upon volume. That is a, here if we'll go for the simplifying the things, then we'll find that per unit volume or in 1 meter cube of a volume, how much amount of the weight of the substance is occupied. That indicates the weight density. Means we'll have the 1 meter cube of a water. In that case, what will be the weight of that 1 meter cube of the water? That ratio of the weight of the water to the volume of the water is nothing but the weight density of the water. So as the weight is nothing but the mass into gravity, so mass into gravity by volume, and mass by volume is nothing but the density. So specific weight is nothing but the product of mass density and the gravity. So, and the unit of the same is nothing but the newton per meter cube. So this is the simplified form. That is, the weight is mass into gravity, and mass into and divided by volume, and mass by volume is density. So density into gravity is nothing but the wet density. We'll see that the effect of pressure and temperature over it. Before that, we'll go as it is dependent on the gravity. So whenever we will change our position, whenever we'll change our position, that is from Earth to the Moon, in that case, the gravity is going to change and the wet density is also going to change. Again, in other words, we can say that the wet density is nothing but the force exerted by a gravity on a unit volume of a fluid or a liquid. That is the product of mass to the gravity. So it is the gravitational force acting on a unit volume of a fluid that is considered as a wet density. As it changes with the position, as I explained previously, as g changes, that is acceleration due to gravity changes from one planet to the another planet, or from one place to the another place, it will move from Earth to the space. In that case, the wet density also changes. So it is a non-absolute value, we can say. We'll consider it's a then effect of pressure and temperature. For the gases, the wet density decreases with increase in a temperature. Now, how is it so? We will consider for a certain time period the gravity as a constant. Again, mass is also a constant thing. So in that case, if you will be there on the Moon, in that case also the gravity of the Moon will be constant and mass obviously a constant. It means that the parameter which is going to change, or parameter which is going to change its volume, is nothing but the volume. So if that volume is going to change, definitely wet density is going to change. It means that whatever the effect we had seen for the mass density, the same effect will be there on the wet density of a pressure and temperature. It means that with increase in a temperature, the volume is going to increase. So as the volume increases, there is an inverse proportion between the wet density and the volume. It means that surely with increase in the temperature, volume increases, so wet density decreases. And vice versa, we can say. Vice versa means it will decrease the temperature. In that case, obviously, there will be increase in a wet density. Then, same case will be there for the pressure. With increase in a pressure, the wet density is also going to increase. As with the increase, with the application of the pressure, this, all the molecules will be get combined together. They will be brought together or close together. So volume is going to reduce. And in that case, as volume decreases, so wet density increases due to the inverse proportion. For water, we'll consider. For water, the wet density will be product of mass density into gravity, that is a rho into g. If you consider the density of the water as a standard one, as a 1000 time being, and g as a 9.81, in that case its magnitude will be 9810 newton per meter cube. This is all about the wet density. Next parameter, next property rather, there is a specific volume which is denoted by a small v, and it is nothing but the volume per unit wet. That is reciprocal of a specific wet. Because in a specific wet, we had seen that weight per unit volume. And in the specific volume, it is the volume per unit wet. So it is reciprocal of a specific wet. It is a volume, and its unit will be meter cube per Newton. But whenever we used to consider the problems of the gas, that is the pipelines of the gas or the gases whenever they are flowing, in that case, instead of considering the wet, we used to consider the volume. So In that case, we used to treat that as a meter mass, we used to consider as a mass. So in that case, we used to consider it as a volume per unit mass for the problems of the gases. Then effect of the pressure and temperature.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir.
Hello.
तुमचा आवाज येत नाहीये सर.
सर्वांनी आपापले व्हिडिओ आणि ऑडिओ बंद करा जेणेकरून बँडविड्थ कमी होईल. जेवढा तुम्ही व्हिडिओ आणि ऑडिओ
जगदाई सर.
हा यस यस
सर बंदच आमचा ऑडिओ.
देन ऑल्सो यू आर नॉट एबल टू लिसन आर हाउ इज इट सो.
जगदाई सर.
हा यस मॅडम.
सर आवाज येत नाही तुमचा. आवाज जरा मोठा पाहिजे.
ओके ओके आवाज मोठा पाहिजे का.
आवाज
आवाज येत नाही.
मोठा नाही सर.
आवाज जरा बघा इथं खूप आला की जरा.
नाही म्हणजे आवाज मोठा पाहिजे असं म्हणायचंय का.
आवाज तुमचा अडकतोय. आवाज
अडकतोय. ओके ओके अडकतोय. ओके 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 रेंजचा प्रॉब्लेम असेल.
शब्द क्लिअर होत नाही सर. काय आवाज एकदम शब्द गाडी जाते.
ओके 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 ओके
अजून पण अडकतो.
आता येतो का क्लिअर. हॅलो हॅलो.
हा हा येतो येतोय थोडं थोडं.
आता क्लिअर येते ना. आय थिंक काही प्रमाणामध्ये आता क्वालिटी इम्प्रूव्ह झालेली असावी.
हो सर.
ओके कॅन वी स्टार्ट फॉर द नेक्स्ट पार्ट. ओके सो वी आर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द स्पेसिफिक व्हॉल्यूम. So specific volume is the volume per unit weight. That is, it is a reciprocal of a specific weight, because the specific weight is the weight per unit volume, and its reciprocal will be nothing but the volume per unit weight. But in case of the flow problems associated with the gases, instead of considering the weight
sir.
Yes. Hello.
Ajuni yet nahi ye clear awaaz. Hello.
Ha are Deshmukh mala awaaz clear yetoy ki tujha.
Hello.
Hello.
Madun madun.
Hello. Ha baga clear yetoy ka.
Hello.
Ha yetoy ka awaaz sarvanna.
नाही सर. लेक्चर स्टार्ट.
जस्ट मिनिट. हा जस्ट मिनिट. जस्ट मिनिट. हा so what will happen right now, I am dealing with the laptop. If you consider for the mobile, in that case it will be difficult for me to record the things. हॅलो येतो करत आवाज सर्वांना. हॅलो हॅलो हॅलो
हॅलो सर,
येतोय का आवाज?
हॅलो,
हा आवाज येतोय का?
हॅलो
हॅलो
हॅलो,
हा आवाज येतोय का? नाही, नेटचा प्रॉब्लेम आहे, आवाज कट होतो, ब्रेक होतो मध्यंतरी. हा चेक करा रे, आता येतो का बाबा? बरं, प्लीज समोर व्हॉट्सअप मी अबाउट द साऊंड. हॅलो
हा बोला की सर,
आता येतोय का आवाज? हॅलो
नाही सर, भरपूर अडकतोय,
कट होतय
खूपच
सर. तुमचं नेटवर्क इश्यू आहे बहुतेक.
जस्ट अ मिनिट, लेट मी चेक इट. नेटवर्क इज देअर यार, हाउ इट हॅपन. सो हॅलो हॅलो हेलो 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 हेलो, नाउ इज इट ऑडिबल. हेलो हेलो, हा अमर प्लीज रिप्लाय मी.
हा सर,
हा येतोय का आवाज?
येतोय, पण अडकतोय सर.
जास्त अडकतोय की कमी अडकतोय?
येतोय
ना. ओके ओके, नाउ वी विल स्टार्ट फॉर.
आता थोडासा कमी झाला, अडकाय
झालंय ना. ओके ओके ओके, नाउ वी विल स्टार्ट फॉर. ओके
हा सर.
Okay, so now all of you please unmute yourself. We'll start further. So we're discussing about the specific volume. So in that we have discussed about the it's a definition and it's a unit, and for the
gases instead of the weight, we used to consider it's a mass. So in that case, we used to consider it's as a ratio of volume per unit mass, that is meter cube per kg as its unit. Then if you consider effect of a pressure and a temperature, in that case, with increase in a temperature, it increases as it is directly proportional to the volume here. So volume per unit mass or volume per unit weight is there. It means that the specific volume, instead of phi here, I had a density here, rho here. So please consider as a phi. So a specific volume phi is directly proportional to the volume. So whenever that volume increases, and volume increases due to the increase in temperature, so specific volume also increases, and vice versa condition. And again, with the increase in pressure, it decreases. As with increase in pressure, the amount of the substance which has been taken in a particular vessel, it get compressed. Means its volume goes on reducing and reducing with increase in pressure. In that case, the density also goes on decreasing and decreasing. Okay, so with increase in pressure, specific volume decreases, and with the increase in temperature, the specific volume also increases. This is applicable purely for the gases. But whenever we used to consider the instead of the gases as the liquids, in that case, the same rate will be there, that same application will be there, but the rate of change, that is either increasing or decreasing, that rate is less, or so less in some of the cases, we can say. But the same thing are going to happen with them. Then if you consider for the water, then a volume per unit volume we are talking about. So weight as either 1000 or 10,000 or 9810 meter cube per second, we can say meter cube per Newton, and it changes with the position, so it is non-absolute quantity. Now we'll consider we'll go for the next property of the fluids, that is a relative density, which is also termed as a specific gravity and denoted by a small s. So relative density, in its name there is a meaning. It is related to something. What related? The density is related to the something else, means the density of the other ones, we can say. So here the density of standard fluids or standard gases are related, we are relating to the densities of the considered fluid or the liquid. Means if you have a certain liquid or a gas, in that case we will compare the density of that certain fluid or a gas with respect to the density of standard fluid or a gas, in that case it is considered as a relative density. So we will check that, how is it so. So a specific gravity or the specific relative density is the ratio of specific weight or mass density. Means whenever we are considering weight, in that case it will be specific weight, and whenever we are considering a density in case of the gases, in that case we are going to consider it as mass density. So it is a ratio of a specific weight or mass density of a liquid or a fluid rather to the specific weight or mass density of a standard fluid. So ratio of specific weight or mass density of a fluid to the specific weight or a density of a standard fluid, that is considered as a relative density or the specific gravity. So here I had quoted herein, whenever we used to consider the specific weight, then specific weight of a fluid to the specific weight of a standard fluid, and where we used to consider a mass density, in that case it is a density of a fluid to the density of a standard fluid. So this is about the specific gravity. As it changes with respect to the temperature, and so in that case, whenever we used to have or whenever we used to consider the specific gravity, in that case the temperature or mentioning the temperature is a precise one. Because we are considering a some liquid with the other liquid, or some liquid to the standard liquid. And whenever temperature changes, in that case, the property changes. It means that ultimately our main motto, that is a relative density, also changes. So whenever is to consider a specific gravity, in that case, temperature is a must. And for water, for liquids, we is to consider, or we is to treat the water as a standard fluid at 4 degrees Celsius. And for gases, hydrogen or air is considered as a standard gas. As specific weight and mass density changes with the temperature, so temperature must be quoted, that is we had explained in the previous one. So if you consider for the standard fluids, that is for water, then specific gravity is a specific weight upon a specific weight of a standard fluid. Here fluid is water, so either mass density of the water upon mass density of a water itself will be there, or a specific weight of water upon specific weight of water will be there. So its ratio will be 1 ultimately. And for mercury, it varies from 13.5 to the 13.6. Either consider as 9810 for water or 1000 as per the conditions. Again, it is a non-absolute quantity. Why non-absolute quantity? Because it changes with the position or a place. If we are knowing the specific gravity, in that case, it's so much easy to find out the mass density or the specific weight of a certain fluid. Suppose that you are knowing the specific gravity of a fluid, then we are knowing the standard fluid will be the water. So specific weight of the fluid is nothing but the product of specific gravity of a fluid into the specific weight of water. Or if you want to calculate the density of the fluid, in that case, if you are knowing the specific gravity, then you could multiply that specific gravity by the density of a standard fluid, that is a water, then you will get directly the density of that considered fluid. That is the another benefit or additional benefit we can say. Then the next we will go for the quiz. Please go through the statement. The ratio of the specific weight of the liquid to the specific weight of a standard fluid is known as. It was asked in the IES examination. So the options are, first one is a specific volume, then weight density, specific gravity, and the viscosity. I will go for once again. The ratio of the specific weight of the liquid to the specific weight of a standard fluid is known as. So obviously the answer will be the C, that is a specific gravity, as we have seen in the previous slide. Now we will have some of the examples. Those were asked in the GATE examination. The small examples, the same examples we used to solve in our theory papers for 4, 5, 6 marks. Those are getting asked for 2 marks maximum in the GATE examinations. The first one we'll go for, those are the standard examples. A 5 meter cube of a certain oil weighs 4000 kgf. That is the weight is given to us. It's a volume is given as a 5 meter cube. It is asked to calculate the specific weight, mass density, and specific gravity. So with the given conditions, the data pertains about volume, that is a 5 meter cube, and its weight as a 4000 kgf, and asked to calculate specific weight, mass density, and the specific gravity. So we'll go for one by one. We are knowing that specific weight is nothing but the weight per unit volume. Weight is given to us 4000 kgf, so 4000 kgf. Volume is given as a 5, so 4000 by 5 we will get the ratio as 800. If we divide the 4000 by 5, so 5 it's a 40 and two zeros are there. It means that 800 and unit will be kgf per meter cube. This is the specific weight we have calculated. Then mass density we have to go for. So mass density is nothing but the ratio of mass upon volume. But here I have quoted as a mass density as a specific weight of oil upon acceleration due to gravity. Now how is it so? As specific weight is nothing but the weight per unit volume, that is mass into gravity upon volume is there. That means the mass by volume into gravity is there, its density into volume is there. We are having a specific weight. So if you want to have a density rho here, then we will be required to multiply. It means we want to calculate the mass upon volume. It means that we'll be required to go for multiplying the things here. So specific weight of the oil upon acceleration due to a gravity. If we'll have this ratio, we'll get directly the mass density. And it comes from the specific weight, that is weight by volume. So we are knowing the specific weight, that is a 800 just now we have calculated, and acceleration due to gravity as a standard we'll consider as a 9.81 meter per second square. So by dividing it, we'll have the ratio as 81.55, that is 81.55, that is the mass density we can say. Then the next parameter is the specific gravity. So specific gravity is nothing but the specific weight of oil upon a specific weight of water, that is a specific gravity. So specific weight of oil is a 800 we have calculated, and for water, that is we used to consider as a 1000 kgf per meter cube, so it will be 0.8. So this is about the quantity. Those are asked from the given things. This is a simplest example. Next one we'll go for. If a 5 meter cube of a certain oil weighs 40 kilonewton, then calculate the specific weight, mass density, and a specific gravity for this oil. So data given includes the volume 5 meter cube and its weight as a 40 kilonewton. And things those are asked to calculate are the same those were asked in the previous example. Only thing is that here force is changed. Okay, so we'll go for one by one. Again, the specific weight of the oil, that is the weight by volume. Then weight is given to us 40 kilonewton, converting to the newton. So that is multiplied it by 1000 divided by volume as a 5. So 5 × 8 = 40. So 8 into 1000 as 8000 newton per meter cube. As the numerator is having unit as a newton and denominator is having unit as a meter cube. So ultimately unit will be newton per meter cube. The next parameter is the mass density. Once again, it is the specific weight of oil upon acceleration due to gravity. There's a relation which we had seen in the previous slides. So specific weight now we are knowing, that is 8000. And acceleration we are knowing, that is a 9.81. We will divide the same. We'll have the ratio as 815.49 kg per meter cube. That is after the unit conversion and all those things, we used to get this as a kg per meter cube. The next one is the specific gravity. It is the ratio of specific weight to the specific weight of a standard fluid. So here the given fluid is oil, so numerator will be specific weight of oil and denominator will be specific weight of water. So water as a standard fluid, so we'll have it as the specific weight of the oil we have calculated it as 8000 newton per meter cube, and that of the water it is 9810 newton per meter cube. So we will have the ratio as 0.815, that is specific gravity of oil is 0.815. so by just quoting the formulas or the equations, we have calculated the things those were asked to calculate. Next one we'll go for, next property we'll go for, that is the viscosity. So the viscosity is nothing but the property of the fluid which or by virtue of which the one layer of the fluid offers a resistance to the movement of another layer over it or below it, we can say. I mean, suppose that the water is a flowing. In that case, when the water is flowing by a gravity, in that case, all the molecules of the water never used to flow, never used to move with the same velocity. It is so because the adjacent molecules of the water, due to the cohesive force, they tries to hold the other molecules, which results in the resistance to the movement of the other molecules. And that is nothing but the viscosity. So in the simplified way, we can say that viscosity is nothing but the resistance offered by one layer of the fluid for the movement of the another layer of fluid. So that is nothing but the viscosity in general. So it is the resistance offered by one layer of liquid to the movement of another layer. It is a primarily due to the cohesive force and the molecular momentum exchange. Momentum exchange means what? The momentum is nothing but the mass into velocity. So whenever the molecules are going to move, in that case, surely the momentum of a particular molecule, that is mass into velocity, is going to change due to the other molecules those are nearby to it. Means what? Suppose that the lowermost molecule is trying to move, or it is moving, and other molecules initially at the rest. In that case, other molecules due to the cohesive force tries to adhere to that molecule, which results in the molecule which is in a motion has its own momentum. That momentum goes on reduction, and other molecules used to get some of the momentum of that. It means that there is a change of a momentum between the fluid layers or the fluid molecules. Okay, and when the flow occurs, in that case, that exchange of the momentum occurs, and these effects appears as a shearing stress between the moving layers of the fluids. As momentum change takes place, it means that the lower layer tries to move the upper layer. In that case, that particular things, that upper layer used to move, means there is a shearing between the layers, and as a shearing occurs, it means that it is the effect of the indirectly the shearing. So as per the Newton's law of viscosity, here Newton's law wrote herein, there is a shear stress tau on a fluid element layer is directly proportional to the rate of a shear strain. That rate of shear strain either will be u by v or du by dy or x to the y, whatever it may be. And the constant of the proportionality is nothing but the viscosity. So here we will get the things. Here this is a lower plate. This is a stationary plate, we can say. And this is a moving plate, and this is the liquid in between. Here, instead of the having the movement of the fluid at its own, we are moving the plate over it. So when plate will be moved over the surface, in that case, obviously, whatever the molecules those are there close to the plate, due to the adhesion, they will be in contact with that. And other molecules lower to that, they will be in contact with each other due to the cohesion. So when the plate will be moved with some force app, there will be the movement of the molecules below it. It means that there will be the movement of one layer, that is a shearing of a layer of the fluid. And as shearing occurs, there will be again a change in momentum, that is whatever the layer will be there which is so close to the upper plate which is moving, that will have the higher velocity. It means that will have higher momentum, and lower molecules have the less momentum. Means there is an exchange of the momentum, and due to the change of a momentum, there is a deformation towards the right hand side, and that deformation here we are considered as the angular deformation. So as per the Newton's law, the shear stress is directly proportional to the angular deformation. So stress is a force upon area, and angular deformation, it is a d theta by dt, we can say. So in general, we used to write at the Newton's law of viscosity as tau is equals to mu into du by dy, whereas du by dy is considered as rate of shear strain or rate of deformation, we can say rate of change of shear strain, and the constant of proportionality mu is considered as an viscosity. As here the forces are involved, as forces are involved means here it is due to the shearing force, so this viscosity is termed as kinetic viscosity. Okay, so we'll discuss in the further part. It is tau is equals, this is the equation by the Newton's law of viscosity. Tau is equals to mu into dv by dy, where mu is a proportionality constant, which is considered as an viscosity. And tau is a shear stress, and dv by dy is nothing but the rate of shear deformation. So this is a coefficient of viscosity. As the forces are involved in it, so it is called as a dynamic viscosity, and it is defined as shear stress required to produce a unit rate of angular deformation. As mu is equals to tau by now, the rate of shear deformation, so by considering the ratio, we can define it in our language. So it will define it, so we can say that the amount of shear stress required to have a deformation of unit rate of angular deformation, that is the shear stress required to produce the unit rate of angular deformation. The SI unit is Newton second per meter square, that is for a dynamic viscosity I'm talking about, or it is also considered as a kg per meter second or Pascal second. Newton second per meter square is nothing but the kg per meter second, or it is a Pascal second, and in a CGS units it is nothing but the poise, that is dyne centimeter, dyne second per centimeter square. If you want to go for the conversion, then 1 Newton second per meter square is equals to 10 poise. So 1 Newton second per meter square is equals to 10 poise. That is the relation. Then the kinematic viscosity. So kinematic viscosity we'll consider as it is the ratio of dynamic viscosity to the density of the fluid. If we'll consider any liquid, in that case we have to consider the density of that particular liquid. So here kinematic viscosity is the dynamic viscosity per unit mass density of that concerned liquid or a fluid. In SI units, the dynamic viscosity nu is expressed in meter square per second, and that of in a CGS units, it is expressed in centimeter square per second, and that centimeter square per second is nothing but the stoke. So we'll see that how to convert the stoke to the meter square per second. As we are knowing that 1 meter square per second is equals to 10 raised to 4 centimeter square per second, and that 10 raised to 4 as it is, and centimeter square per second is nothing but the stoke. It means that 1 meter square per second is equals to 10 raised to 4 stokes. That is the relation between the SI unit and the CGS unit of kinematic viscosity nu. Then in the next part we'll consider the further part. The dynamic viscosity mu of either a liquid or a gas is practically independent of the pressure. It means that if the pressure changes, it doesn't have an appreciable change on the dynamic viscosity. However, it varies widely with respect to the temperature. So whenever temperature changes, there is a change in the dynamic viscosity. We'll see that how it changes and all. So for gases, the viscosity changes with the increase in a temperature. Whereas for the liquids, it decreases with increase in temperature. Now, how it happens so? So for gases, when temperature increases, in that case, the bonding between the molecules goes on increasing and increasing. So as bonding increases, it means that the resistance offered by one layer to the another layer goes on increases. It means that the cohesive force increases in case of the gases with increase in temperature. So as temperature increases in case of the gases, cohesive force increases, which leads in maximum resistance to the movement, which results in increase in the viscosity. Whereas in case of the liquids, with increase in the temperature, the cohesive force decreases. The molecules tries to go away from each other. They separate from each other. It means that the resistance offered by them to movement of one another is goes on reducing and reducing. It means that it goes on decreases. Because next further parts, in liquids, the viscosity is governed by the cohesive forces between the molecules of the liquids, and for the gases, it is for the molecular activities. That is the kinematic viscosity of liquids and of gases at a given pressure is essentially a function of a temperature. Means for gases, it increases with the temperature, and for liquids, it decreases with the temperature. So as per the viscosity and Newton's law of viscosity, the fluids are considered as a Newtonian fluid and non-Newtonian fluid. So Newtonian fluids are those fluids, those obeys the Newton's law of viscosity. That is, and the non-Newtonian fluids are those fluids, those doesn't obey the Newton's law of viscosity. As simple as. The next part we'll go for the quiz in general. The decrease in temperature in general results in, go for the statement clearly. The decrease in a temperature in general results in, options are, increase in viscosities of both gases and liquids. Second option, decrease in the viscosity of both liquids and gases. Third option, increase in the viscosity of liquids and decrease in the viscosity of the gases. And next option, decrease in the viscosity of the liquids and increase in the viscosity of the gases. The question is that we are decreasing the temperature. If we will decrease the temperature, in that case, obviously, there will be the change in the viscosity. But we are knowing that with change in a temperature, the viscosity of the fluids, that is gases and the liquids, doesn't move in a one line. It means that one increases and another decreases with change in a temperature. It means that first two options are not valid over, isn't it? Because with the temperature, the viscosity of the one of the material increases and another one is decreases, that we had seen. So the correct option is that with decrease in a temperature, the viscosity of liquid increases, and for the gases, it is a decreases. That is, option C is the correct option. Now we'll move further. Newton's law of viscosity depends upon the. Newton's law of viscosity is depends upon. The first option is stress and strain in a fluid. Second option, shear stress, pressure and velocity. Third option, shear stress and rate of strain. Fourth option, viscosity and shear stress. So go through the statement clearly. Newton's law of viscosity depends upon. Someone has raised as option C. Please do have such type of the notations, either arrow or just mark the point over. Please, other peoples, and it's my humble request to all of you, please stop your videos. I'm finding that some of the persons are having their videos. They have started their video. Please stop the videos, because if you stop your videos, it will be easy to reduce the bandwidth and it will be convenient to reach the audio clearly to all the participants. Other persons? Three, four answers I got. That is a C option I got from 4 to 5 participants. Can we go for answer? Another one again I got. That is a C option. They are saying that the Newton's law of viscosity is dependent upon shear stress and rate of strain. Can you go for answer? Again, I got the answer. Same answer I got from someone else. I'm getting also. Can I tell the names from whom I got the answers? Okay, time being, I will not go for the naming herein. Great. Again, I got the answer. Same answer I'm getting. So we'll go for the answer of that. The answer is C. That is shear stress and rate of strain. That rate of strain, that is a shear strain, we can say. So the Newton's law of viscosity depends upon the shear stress and rate of strain. That is the answer for that quiz. Now we'll go for the next one. Please erase that, whatever the things you did there. Okay, good. Now we'll go for the next part. I hope so all of you have stopped their videos. Now we'll see the some of the numericals. Those were asked, the MCQs and numericals, those I have considered over here in, those are asked in the examinations, okay? So the a plate of 0.0254 millimeter, the thickness they had given us, distance from a fixed plate moves at 61 centimeter per second and requires a force of 0.2 kgf per meter square to maintain this speed, and determine the dynamic viscosity of the fluid between the plates. So things those are given to us, that is the distance between the two plates, that is a 0.0254, and the velocity is given as 61 centimeter per second, and the force is 0.2 kgf per meter square, and asked to calculate dynamic viscosity. We'll see that, as we are knowing that from the shear stress, from the base, we'll go for tau is equals to force upon area. Shear stress is equal to force upon area, that is equals to mu into dv by dy, that is the shear strain. It's mu into phi by y. So tau is given to us, that is a 0.2 kgf, that is a force that is given to us. Then velocity is given, 61 centimeter per second, converting the units to the meter per second. So 61 by 10 will be 100 will be there. So that will be 0.61 meter per second. And the y, that is a distance between two plates, is given 0.0254 millimeter. If you convert to the meters, it will be required to multiply it by 10 raised to minus 5. Okay. And by substituting those things, we'll get 0.2, that is a tau, is equals to mu into phi as a 0.61 and y as a 2.54 into 10 raised to minus 5. That is, mu is equals to 0.2 into 2.54 into 10 raised to 5, rearranging the terms, minus 5 into 0 by 0.61, it yields the answer as 8.328 into 10 raised to minus 10 kgf² per centimeter square. Next one we'll go for. At a certain point in a castor oil, means there is a oil, castor oil, and at a certain point the shear stress is 0.216 newton per meter square, and the velocity gradient is 0.216 per second. If the mass density of the castor oil is 959.42 kg per meter cube, what should be its kinematic viscosity? The same example was asked in the GATE examination. Only thing is that the parameters were changed. And this is a solved example from one of the book. Only the in the GATE, the parameters were changed. Now we'll see the solution of the same. From the base itself, there is a shear stress, tau is equals to mu into dv by dy, that is a Newton's law viscosity. The things those are given to us, that is a shear stress tau is given to us, 0.216 newton per meter square, and velocity gradient, that is a dv by dy, is given to us, 0.216 per second. Okay, again the density is also given to us, 959.42 kg per meter cube, and it is asked to calculate kinematic viscosity. So by substituting the things, we will get directly the tau as a 0.216, mu is unknown to us, we will calculate that, and 0.216 as given to us. So 0.216, 0.216 will get cancels to each other, so we'll get the mu directly as 1 newton second per meter square, that is by rearranging the units. Okay, then it is asked to calculate the kinematic viscosity. And for finding the kinematic viscosity, they had given us a density, because kinematic viscosity is the ratio of dynamic viscosity and the density. So mu is equals to mu by rho. So mu as a 1 and rho, that density, as a 959.42. So we used to get it as a 1.042 into 10 raised to minus 3 meter square per second. So if you have observed the things here, the numericals those we are getting asked in the examinations are so simple. Only thing is that we should know the basic formulas and equations. So only the values was got changed and same was asked in the examination. So we'll proceed for the next part. Next example, in a certain liquid, if a certain liquid has a viscosity of 4.9 into 10 raised to minus 4 kgf² per meter square, and the kinematic viscosity as 3.49 10 raised to minus 2 stokes, what is the specific gravity? So here they had given as a certain liquid has a viscosity. So whenever there is not mentioned, in that case, we have to consider is a dynamic viscosity. So dynamic viscosity is a 4.9 into 10 raised to minus 4, and kinematic viscosity is 3.49 into 10 raised to minus 2. And is asked to calculate the specific gravity. So we'll see that. So kinematic viscosity, we are knowing that nu is equals to mu by rho. And from that, we'll get the density as, rearranging the terms, we'll get the density as mu by nu. So the density is the ratio here of mu and nu. So mu is known to us for 4.9 into 10 raised to minus 4 kgf² per meter square. And nu is given into the stokes. So we'll be required to change its unit, that is given in a CGS unit. We'll be required to convert it into the MKS or the SI unit. So SI unit, already we are knowing that the stokes, conversion of meter square per second to the stoke. So that is 100, 10, 100. So It will be 3.49 into 10 raised to minus 6 meter square per second. Now the units are got balanced. So we'll get the density here. It is a 4.9 into 10 raised to 4, that is a mu, divided by nu as a 3.49 into 10 raised to minus 6. So we got the density as 144.4. Now it has been asked to calculate the specific gravity. The specific gravity, they had given us for the liquid. It means that the specific gravity of the liquid will be equal to the mass density of a liquid to the mass density of the standard liquid. As density is given, so we'll consider it as a density. If they had given us as a specific weight, then in that case we have be considered here as a specific weight. But as the density is given to us, so we will have the ratio of mass density of the liquid to the mass density of the water. Water is the standard liquid. So the density of the liquid we have calculated as 140.4, and for the mass density of the water in the same unit of the SL per meter cube is 102. So we will have the specific gravity of the liquid as 1.38. If you convert the units from kgf to the regular units, then also it works and it used to yield the value as the same, that is a 1.38. Okay, so this is about the example which we have considered. Now the next one, a rectangular plate of size 25 centimeter by 50 centimeter. It means the area is given to us and weighing 25 kgf, its weight is given to us, slides down a 30 degree inclined surface in a at a uniform velocity of 2 meter per second. This rectangular plate is there and it is sliding down at a 30 degree with a uniform velocity of 2 meters per second. If the uniform 2 millimeter gap between the plate and the inclined surface is filled with oil, means there is oil and through which it is moving at an angle of 30 degree, it is filled with oil, then find the viscosity of the oil. So velocity is given to us, area is given to us, weight of the plate is given to us, its angle is given to us, and the gap is given to us. Okay, so here the whole weight will not be responsible to have its movement. Only the component of the weight along that angle will be responsible to the movement of the plate with a 2 meters per second. So we'll see that is when the plate is moving with a uniform velocity of 2 meters per second, the viscous resistance to the motion will be equal to the component of the weight of the plate along the sloping surface. It means that whatever the viscous resistance offered by the oil will be somewhat equal to the component of the weight in the direction of motion. That is as per the equilibrium, we can say, but it is moving. So in that consideration also, by the law of D'Alembert's principle also, we can say that it will be same one. So as per that principle, we are assuming that the component of the weight of the plate along the sloping surface will be equals to the viscous resistance of the oil. So here, as angle is 30 degree, okay, so the component of the weight of the plate along the plane, it will be equals to the 25 sine 30. Okay, so angle will be 30 degree. So sine component will be the along the plate. So in that case, we'll have the net weight, which is responsible to have the motion, is a 12.5 kgf. Now the viscous resistance of the total area offered, surface area, that is contact area, that will be shear stress into the area. So that will be tau into A. So that is equals to tau as a mu into dy by dv by dy into the A. So that is dv by dy is nothing but the v by y into the area. V is given 2 meters per second. Y is given, that is a gap distance between the two plates, 2 into 2 millimeters, that means 2 into 10 to -3 meters, and area is a 0.25 into 50, 25 centimeters by 50 centimeters, converting to the meters. So we'll have 0.25 into 0.50 meters squared. So putting the values over here, we'll get viscous resistance is equals to mu into, as mu is not given, so we'll be moving further ahead as like that, as like this, into the 2 upon 2 is a y, sorry, 2 as a v, and 2 into 10 to -3 as a y, into area as a 0.25 into 0.5. So we got the viscous resistance as 125 times mu. Mu is still unknown to us. So now how to get it? Just equating the two terms, that is a 12.5 and 125 mu. So here, by equating the things, that is a 12.5 is the force required to have the motion, and that is equals to the total resistance, that is a viscous resistance, and total viscous resistance is 125 mu. So 125 mu will be equated to the 12.5, that is a weight. From that we get the mu as 0.1 kg of second per square meter. Okay, so next part we'll consider is about the vapor pressure. So what does it mean about the vapor pressure firstly? So the vapor pressure is nothing but, so whenever we used to close any liquid in a container at a certain temperature, we used to observe that the some air bubbles or the some molecules used to move from lower surface to the top surface, that is from bottom to the top. Those air bubbles are nothing but the vapors of the, or the air pockets, we can say, vapors from that liquid, of that liquid. And when those, when that vapor used to occupy all the space which is available between the top surface of the liquid and the top surface of the container or the vessel, in that case, they, with increasing their number, that is number in molecules in per unit volume, they starts exerting the pressure over the top surface of the liquid. And that pressure exerted by the vapors or the bubbles or the molecules over air molecules, we can say, or the vapor molecules, we can say, over the top surface of the liquid is considered as a vapor pressure. It happens at all the temperatures. Okay, so when the pressure exerted by accumulated vapor pressure on the surface of liquid in a closed vessel, that pressure is considered as a vapor pressure, and it happens at all the temperatures. If temperature increases, obviously that vapor, rate of formation of vapor increases. If rate of formation of vapor increases, it means that vapor pressure also increases. It's the best example is our pressure cooker. Initially in the pressure cooker, we used to have the cold water and we used to heat it. So when we used to heat it, it converts, that water starts converting into the vapors. So molecules changes its phase, and when they, all the vapors goes in upper surface, that is a gap which we have kept between the top surface of the water and the top surface of the cooker, that occupies completely. And when that all the space has been got occupied by the vapor, further increase in the temperature results in the increase in pressure. And after sometimes we used to heard the sound from the of the vessel, shuttle, we can say. So त्यावेळेस काय होतं आपल्याला की आपल्याला बरोबर त्या कुकरचा आपल्याला शिट्टीचा आवाज येतो. शिट्टीचा आवाज येतो म्हणजेच काय होतं, तर त्यावेळेस त्या प्रेशर मधला जो वेपर प्रेशर वाढलेला असतो, तो वेपर प्रेशर बिअर करण्या इतका लोड किंवा तेवढं वेट त्या वरती आपण लावलेल्या त्या शिट्टीचा असतो. मग त्या तेवढा वेट जर का बॅलन्स झाला की बरोबर त्याच्यापेक्षा जास्त प्रमाणामध्ये प्रेशर वाढला की ऑटोमॅटिकली आपल्याला साऊंड ऐकायला येतो. दॅट इज द आयडियल ऑर एक्झाम्पल ऑफ अ वेपर प्रेशर वी कॅन से. इट इन्क्रीजेस विथ द टेम्परेचर दॅट वी हॅड सीन दॅट इज विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू द एक्झाम्पल ऑफ अ प्रेशर कुकर. देन इफ इट इज अनदर वन एक्झाम इट इज आयडियल कंडिशन विच इज मोस्ट conceptual we can say, which is applicable hereafter. That is, if the atmospheric pressure is reduced to the vapor pressure, then what does happens? Just imagine the condition. We have a vessel, closed vessel is there, or a vessel is open to atmosphere is there, and whatever the atmospheric pressure is there, that atmospheric pressure we have changed or we have reduced to the vapor pressure. And when we used to reduce that vapor atmospheric pressure to the vapor pressure, the whatever amount of the vaporization is there, it goes on increasing and increasing. And when it happens, in that case, we used to observe that the liquid is boiling. It means that the number of molecules are, air molecules are coming in upward direction in the gap which is there in between the top surface of the vessel and the atmosphere, we can say. So whenever atmospheric pressure is reduced to the vapor pressure, then liquid starts boiling at that temperature, whatever it may be. At 0 degrees Celsius, if you have reduced the atmospheric pressure to the vapor pressure, then it starts boiling. If at 30 degrees Celsius temperature, if you have reduced the atmospheric pressure to the vapor pressure of that vessel or that liquid, in that case also that liquid starts the boiling. And this is the most precise critical condition which is considered in the design of the hydraulic machines, that is the pumps, jets, turbines, etc., etc. The next one, that is, if you consider the mercury, then a mercury has a very low vapor pressure, and hence it is an excellent fluid to be used in the barometers, as the sublimation of the mercury is so less, means it is having a low, very low vapor pressure. That's why it is used in the barometers or in the pressure measuring devices such as an manometers. This is an ideal property we can say for the mercury. It is low vapor pressure. And for the water, we can consider, if you compare the water and the mercury, so water is having high vapor pressure. Means the sublimation rate of the water is so high, that's why at the same temperature, if you close or if you have the water and the mercury in the same type of the vessels, in that case we used to observe that the vapor pressure exerted by water is high than that of the vapor pressure exerted by the mercury. That is the advantage of the mercury, which is used in the measurement of the pressure measurement devices. In the next part, so I know that time is over, so we'll stop here, and further remaining part we'll continue in the next next lecture. So time being, only one part has been there in, that is that we had seen for the vapor pressure, we had seen for the mercury. But for on other hand, that is if you consider the gases and the volatile liquids as petrol, kerosene, etc. Petrol, kerosene, they used to have the high vapor pressure because they starts boiling at solar temperature, so less temperature. That is the thing, and we'll stop here. We'll resume for the next lecture.
Presentee.
Yes. Amar, you to take the present of all the things.
Oh, me kai na bollo.
Amar,
जस्ट
अबे अबे ए मैं नहीं बोल लो
ये अबे आगे
अभिजीत चवन है
ए सुमित पवार मैं कुछ बोल रहा रे
हाँ आई डिड म्यूट ऑफ
B64
ओके here after what you do you just mention your roll numbers as a
rasaunga kay da nahi baga adakle
A10 A60 A70
avaz adko adkodo tavar cover pur sir
okay okay here for next lecture I am going to change the network so that it will be easy
purte lagte usme tower ke liye bas asta
kay jal mhatle